Player input is one of those things that seems straightforward at first, but becomes super complicated the moment you need to do anything advanced, like support multiple controllers. Luckily for us, Unity's new input system solves a lot of the headaches that are caused by using the current input API. In this video, I'm going to show you how to use a key feature of the new input system, called input actions, to support multiple controllers in your game with just a few lines of code. But before we jump into that, let's take a quick look at the example project that we'll be using throughout this tutorial. This is the player script. Its job is to consume input and move the player character around the scene. It does this using basic transform-based logic that can be found in the update method. This logic looks simple at first glance because most of the heavy lifting is done by a set of calculated properties. These properties do all of the computational work. They aren't concerned with anything else. So, where does player input factor in? Well, input is handled by two directional properties, vertical and horizontal. Their values are pulled directly from the keyboard using the static keyboard device class, which is available in Unity's new input system API. If you haven't seen it yet, check out my tutorial on migrating to the new input system. In that video, I walk through the creation of this code, so it may be easier to follow along if you watch that first. But in a nutshell, the property getters simply check the W and S keys for vertical movement and the D and A keys for horizontal movement, and return -1, 0, or +1, based on the key that's currently being pressed. The values that they return are then fed into the rest of the computational logic that you just saw. Now, if we switch to Unity and hit play, we can see that the code works just fine. But the player is limited to a single type of controller, the keyboard. And not just the keyboard, but the W, A, S, and D keys. I want to be able to support multiple types of input at the same time. And in this video, I'm going to show you how to do that using input actions. But first, if you'd like to follow along, then head on over to my Patreon page where you can download the example project free of charge. I've split it up into two folders, before and after, so you can code along as you watch or just skip to the finished product. Either way, it's time to get to work. So let's get started. The first thing we need to do is introduce some input action fields to represent the player's axis-based input. Create a private serialized input action field for each direction: up, down, left, and right. The input action class encapsulates input from one or more sources. A source can be a controller, a gamepad, or, in our case, a keyboard. You assign input action sources using bindings, which we can set from the editor. Switch back to Unity and select the player game object. The player component should now have a property drawer for each direction field. Each drawer displays the name of the field along with a plus and minus sign, which are used to add and remove bindings. Go ahead and click the plus sign for the up field and select binding. Then, double-click the empty binding that's automatically generated. This is probably a good time to mention that for this tutorial, I'll be using Unity 2018.3.5 Feature 1 and the 0.2.0 preview version of the Unity Input System package. And while I think that a lot of the high-level concepts will remain the same, it's highly possible that some aspects of this tutorial will change over the course of the next year or so, including some of the UIs that we're about to use. But don't worry. If you run into any issues, just check the comments to see if I or anyone in the community has posted a solution. Or feel free to hop onto the public Discord server. We've got a great community that's always willing to help. All right, let's get back into it. So again, double-click the empty binding and select the dropdown next to the word path. This is where we'll bind the actual control to the input action. Search for and select the W key. Now, the W key is bound to up. Let's switch back to the code editor and add some debug statements so we can see it in action. Input actions have callbacks for events that are triggered during their life cycles. The ones we're interested in are the performed and canceled events. Go ahead and register an anonymous function that logs each of UP's events. The performed event is fired when the control that's bound to its input action receives input, and the canceled event is fired when that control stops receiving input. Now, before we can test this functionality out, we need to enable and disable the input action. We can do this by implementing the Unity event functions onEnabled and onDisabled, and making a call to enable and disable, respectively. All right, let's switch back to Unity and run the scene. Now, focusing on the console, press and hold the W key. Check it out. The performed event has been logged, just as expected. Now, let go of the W key. And there's the log for the canceled event. Beautiful. While we're here, let's add bindings to the rest of our direction fields. We'll bind S key to down, the D key to right, and the A key to left. Awesome. Now, let's switch back to the code editor so we can flesh out the rest of our implementation. We need to start taking advantage of our bindings by using the input action events to set the vertical and horizontal properties instead of having them pull the keyboard directly. But before we can do that, we need to convert them to plain old auto properties. Let's go ahead and do that now. We just need to strip out the logic and expose some setters. Now, we can set vertical to positive 1 when UP's performed event is fired, and 0 when its canceled event is fired. Let's test it out. Switch back to Unity, press play, and then press the W key. Nice. Now let go. Beautiful. Back in the code editor, we can go ahead and fill out the rest of the logic. For input on down, set the vertical property to negative 1. For input on right, set the horizontal property to positive 1. And for input on left, set the horizontal property to negative 1. Last but not least, let's not forget to enable and disable each of our input actions. All right, let's test it out. Switch back to Unity, run the scene, and let's just move around the scene. Beautiful. Now, for fun, why don't we bind some additional keys to our directional input? How about I, K, J, and L? Bind I to up, K to down, J to left, and L to right. Awesome. Let's press play one more time and test out the new bindings. Works like a charm. But I will say, setting even 2 bindings for each direction is already starting to feel a little cumbersome. I can't imagine what this property drawer is going to look like with 3, 4, or even 5 control schemes. Luckily, we can make this much cleaner by adding just 1 level of sophistication. Instead of having an input action for each direction, we can use 1 to encapsulate them all using a special binding called a composite. Switch back to the code editor and I'll show you what I mean. Add a private serialized input action field called movement. Then, register a listener to its performed event. Let's register an actual method this time. We can call it onMovementPerformed. Next, let's read a vector2 value from the event's callbackContext parameter by calling readValue and passing in vector2 as the generic parameter. Now, we can use this value to set the horizontal and vertical properties. Voila! And what's great is that we can even reuse this method for the cancel event as well. Great. Last but not least, let's enable and disable movement, just like we did for the other input actions. And of course, we should clean up our class by removing all of the other input action fields, which are now deprecated. Perfect. Now, we can switch back to Unity and create our binding. To recreate our previous behavior, we'll need to add two composite bindings to movement. We can do this by clicking the plus sign and selecting Composite, 2D Vector. Now, there's a small bug in this version of the input system. You need to run the scene once in order to generate the binding options. Let's go ahead and do that now. There they are. Now we can set them accordingly. Again, we'll use the same controls that we used before. Perfect. Run the scene. Move around a little bit. Beautiful. It works perfectly, and the code looks much better. All right. At this point, we're pretty much done covering the basics of input actions. But I want to make one small refactoring before we wrap things up. So let's switch back to the code editor. With our new code in place, the vertical and horizontal properties have become nothing more than middlemen whose only job is to set the direction property. Why don't we go ahead and cut them out? And set the direction property directly within the event callback. Much better. As always, we'll pop back into Unity one more time, hit play, and test it out. Beautiful. All right, so this seems like a good place to stop. We've added multi-controller support with just a few lines of code. It's a nice, clean solution to a very common problem. But it isn't perfect. The input action approach can become more and more unwieldy as you begin to support more controllers. In the next video, we'll explore another feature of the new input system that'll help solve this problem. You won't want to miss it. If you enjoyed this video, then please leave a like and a comment letting me know what you thought. And for more Unity tutorials just like this one, don't forget to subscribe with notifications on. Thanks for watching, and I'll catch you in the next video. Thank you to all of my patrons, and a special shout out to NZ, Richard Stance, Sean Carey, Thomas, Willendingo, and Yagov.